So let's start by saying on record that this is the second interview that we are doing. I really enjoyed our first interview. Thank you very much. But unfortunately, I made a mistake with my Zoom recording and I ended up recording myself twice. So we asked you for a second interview and you said yes. I am extremely grateful. I really appreciate it. Thank you very much.
Well, I enjoyed the conversation and, you know, these things happen. Although I'm suspicious that you were just more interested in your own thoughts. So maybe you want to record yourself twice, you know.
I always talk too much anyway. So this is your book in Greek. The title is Ευρυγνωσία, ευρύ meaning wide or range, and γνωσία from γνώση meaning knowledge.
The first time, I think when you showed it to me last time, it was the first time I've seen the cover, so I'm glad to see it.
I was wondering, I mean, different colors, different feel. How do you feel about it?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's cool that it's a different design in every, you know, I trust the publishers to sort of know the aesthetics of their market better than I do. And I think it's interesting to see the imagery that different designers come up with.
So I read your book. I really enjoyed it. I think it is actually one of the best books I've read in a long time. I think it is well written, it is fun to read, it is amazingly researched, and the argument that you do persuaded me. But the truth is that maybe I like the book because it made me feel good about myself. I consider myself a generalist, I sampled a lot, I specialized late in my studies, in my profession, I got married late, I became a father late, but your book made me feel that maybe the way I did it was actually better. So thank you for this book. Help me. So my first question is, what was your journey? How did you discover the benefits of range in your life, in your experiences?
Well, certainly accidentally at first. I mean, I didn't, and I think that's sort of typical, actually, for the most part. So I didn't plan to sort of become a wide-ranging person or a generalist or anything like that. In fact, when I was a teenager, I thought I knew exactly what I was going to do. I wanted to go to the Air Force and be a test pilot and then be an astronaut. So I went to college and started studying. And I was on that track and sort of a few things happened. One was I went to grad school, started to grad school in the environmental sciences where I was living in a tent in the Arctic Circle, studying the climate change and the carbon cycle and things like that, and realizing that really I was being sort of encouraged or pushed to study things that were so niche because you had to study something that no one else had studied before. And in many cases, that meant, you know, there was a reason that people hadn't studied those things before because maybe they were either boring or not very important. And so there was this drive to become like the world's singular expert in something that often, you know, was not particularly important or particularly interesting sometimes. And so I started to ask myself, you know, am I the type of person who wants to spend my whole life learning sort of one or two things new to the world, or much shorter spans of time learning things new to me and kind of synthesizing them and sharing them? And I was realizing I was more that latter personality where, you know, my scientific curiosity was better satisfied by taking classes and by, you know, eventually by interviewing than it was really by working, you know, as a scientist. And that kind of, I was having that realization around the same time, similar time, that there was sort of a personal tragedy in my life where I was a competitive runner and one of my training partners died at the end of a race, you know, a guy who was like Olympic development caliber person in the United States. And I really wanted to know how that could happen. And I ended up basically investigating that and finding out that he had this, you know, he had this genetic disease that's usually the cause of sudden unexpected death in athletes. It was misdiagnosed and all these things. And I started to have this idea, you know, I want to merge my interest in science and my interest in sports and write about something that's meaningful to me to like raise awareness about this disease and hopefully save more people. And so I did that. And as I got into the journalism world doing that, you know, I started at Sports Illustrated, which is the biggest sports magazine in the United States, as a temp fact checker. Like, you know, I was the lowest on the totem pole and I was doing like remedial work for people 5 or 6 years younger than me. But I got there, and again, with this idea of writing about sudden cardiac death in athletes, and realized that whereas I had these sort of like average science skills, I would say, I was probably shaping up to be like a fine, but, you know, okay scientist. You bring those sort of average skills over to a sports magazine, and it's like you're a Nobel laureate all of a sudden. Like you've got something that's so rare. And I realized that I didn't have to kind of compete directly with other people. If I just overlapped these sort of unusual experiences, I only had to compete with myself. And so once I realized that, I started, you know, writing about sports science and medicine, and I sort of zoomed past and became the youngest senior writer at the place after being a temp fact checker. And that realization that I can take this, that I can take this combination of things. Some people call this skill stacking, where instead of being like the absolute greatest at any one thing, you're sort of, you know, good or competent in a number of things, and the way they overlap makes you totally unique. And so that became kind of the strategy for my career. And I, when I was reporting on range, I really recognized that in, you know, some of the research I was reading, like the Dark Horse Project at Harvard, that was looking at how do people find fulfilling careers? How do they find so-called match quality, which is the term economists use to describe the degree of fit between someone's interests and abilities in the work that they do. And what these people do is they try something. They don't look around and say, here's who's younger than me and has more than me. They say, here's who I am right now. Here are my skills and interests. I'm going to take this opportunity. The opportunity is in front of me. I'm going to take this one. And maybe a year from now, I'll change because I will learn something about myself, or my opportunities will have changed. And they keep doing that until they kind of come closer and closer into things that are like a good fit for them. And I realized that's kind of what I was doing. And that turns out to be, you know, according to this research at Harvard, the norm for people who find fulfilling work. And because they have to go through that journey, they are almost inevitably behind, you know, their age matched peers at some stage of their careers until they find their spot and really grow very, very quickly. Sorry, that was a very long answer.
No, it's great. It takes me to the next question, actually, because you mentioned Harvard in Greece. We hear Harvard and we say it's the top thinkers, the top discoverers and experimenters in the world. And we live in 2022. Why is it that now we are talking about this? Why do we realize we discover now the benefits of range, the benefits of actually structuring education in a way to support range and generalization and sampling? Why did we live with specialization as the norm for so long? What happened? It doesn't sell, it doesn't work. It is difficult to explain.
I think there are a few different issues, and the difficulty of explaining it is one. Like, say, you know, there's been this mounting research now for years about the benefits of having this sort of wide toolkit and diverse experiences in your background. At the same time, you know, our brains have been evolving for much, much longer than that. And I think it's our intuition to think in a more sort of short-term way, right? And so when we see, you know, two people, for example, who are separated by, you know, this much at a given point in time in whatever skill or whatever career progression or whatever it is they're doing, our brains see that as a stable trajectory, right? They're going to be separated by that much forever. But all of the human development and expertise development literature, except in like the most basic tasks that everyone can master and everything else, development looks like this. It's like there are these papers that talk about dips, plateaus, and peaks, you know, that's how development of expertise and career development works. And so one, I think we're working against our intuition, right? Because like I say, I think a less marketable, but like absolutely true subtitle of the book could have been that sometimes the things that appear to give you a head start can actually undermine your long-term development, whether that's choosing a career, choosing what to study, or literally the way that you learn something like math. And so I think we're fighting our intuition, for one. And I think, you know, it's more complicated to allow room for this sort of zigzagging development than it is to just tell someone, hey, do this thing and just stick with it. But I also think that a higher degree of specialization made more sense for a larger number of people, you know, for maybe our parents and grandparents, because they were living in a more industrial kind of economy that changed a little more slowly. Like they could work next year for them often looked like work last year. You know, there was change, but it wasn't at the same breakneck pace.
So you're saying that it has to do with the era, the times that we're living, that maybe 50 years ago, the world was a kind learning environment, but now we become wickeder and wickeder.
Yeah, absolutely. To introduce those terms a little bit. So those are terms I use in the book that are taken from a psychologist named Robin Hogarth. And what he means by kind learning environment are situations where kind of the next steps and goals are clear. Rules are very clear and never change. Patterns repeat. Feedback is quick and accurate. Not a lot of human behavior involved. And again, work next year will look like work last year, more or less. And on the other end of this spectrum that Hogarth studied is what he called wicked learning environments, where next steps and goals, you may have to come up with them. Rules may change if there are rules. Human behavior is involved. Patterns don't just repeat. Feedback could be delayed or inaccurate. Work next year may not look like work last year. And increasingly, now we spend time in both kind and wicked learning environments, no question about it. And you know, it's a spectrum and many things between, but increasingly more of the work that more of us are spending our time in is actually, you know, this more wicked learning environment where you're having to think in these interdisciplinary ways and having to do what psychologists call transfer, which is taking knowledge and skills and applying it to problems that you've never quite seen before. So you have to kind of leverage what you have to be able to do things that you haven't directly experienced. And there's this classic finding in expertise literature that can be summarized as, and again, I'm taking this phrase from a psychologist named Dietrich Gentner, breadth of training predicts breadth of transfer. So transfer, again, is your ability to take what you have and apply it to problems you haven't seen before. Breadth of training means like the diversity of skills and problem solving experiences and things like that you've had in the past. So that breadth you've had in the past predicts your ability to transfer knowledge. And most of us are now in a world where we have to be transferring knowledge if we want to succeed constantly. We have to be relearning, we have to be solving problems we haven't exactly seen before. And so it's that world where you need a lot of transfer that these broad toolkit that can sometimes feel a little bit behind when you're compiling it, turns out to be this incredible asset.
What we are living now in the last 10 years, maybe, are we in such a deep where we are relearning what we do, where we feel that we are behind from the progress that we thought we should have by now, but borders opened, we are communicating throughout the world with all the countries, with all the people. It looks like we're playing a one-man sport, like golf, where you are just against yourself, or like swimming. But now we are like in a multiplayer game with everything. Right. We don't know what the game is right now.
Right, right, exactly. No, it's so much more complicated. That's right. So when Hogarth was describing, where you said we don't know what the game is right now, that resonates, because when Hogarth was writing about the kind of wicked learning environments. And by the way, one of the reasons he was doing this was because there was this kind of conundrum in scientific literature about how people develop skills and expertise. And the conundrum was that some people were seeing that repetitive experience developed expertise and made people a lot better. And others were seeing that it didn't do that. Not only did it not make them better, it often made them more confident, but no better, which was a really bad combination. And often prone to something called the Einstellung effect, which is where you've practiced a certain way to solve a problem so much that you'll keep doing that even if it's the wrong way. So one of the examples that's kind of harrowing examples of this is that I mentioned in the book are these two, again, Harvard-led studies that found that if you're checked into a teaching hospital, a hospital associated with the university in the US, with certain cardiac conditions on the dates of a national cardiology convention, when the most esteemed cardiologists are away, you're less likely to die, because it turns out you're less likely to get certain procedures that those specialists have gotten very, very good at doing, but will continue to do even when it's not the right thing to do anymore, right? It's not that they're not like bad, it's that they've fallen prey to this Einstellung effect where you've done something too many times over and over and over. But so to go back, you mentioned, you know, we don't even know what game we're playing. So Hogarth said, you know, we think that we're playing tennis sometimes, where you can see everything that's happening, but really a lot of modern work is much more like what he called Martian tennis, which is like someone dropped you in the stadium and you know there's something going on, but you don't know the rules. You have to try to figure them out and they can change without notice. Yes. I said that's much more like the situation that we're in. And so it's a more difficult challenge. And there's no way around that. Like, it's a more difficult challenge. And so development for that challenge is also more difficult.
I realized when you mentioned the second, the Plan B subtitle of the book, that it is actually, it is a book about the benefits of range, but it's also a huge attack on specialization. And I think there was a judgment call on which way to present it, and you chose the positive side. We feel that we should talk about specialization and the bad things that it has done and how many people it has trapped. So if let's say there is someone who feels trapped in a specialized work, in a specialized whatever, how can he escape from that? Are there tools? Can you give him an advice, give them an advice?
Yeah, and first, let me just say that I think overall, the way I look at this issue is very much akin to how sort of one of my intellectual heroes framed it, a man named Freeman Dyson, who was one of the most important physicists and mathematicians of the 20th century and a brilliant writer also, passed away just about 3 years ago. And Dyson gave this speech where he said, if we want to have a healthy ecosystem, we need both birds and frogs. He said, frogs are kind of down in the mud looking at the granular details of problems. The birds are soaring up above. They're not seeing those granular details, but they are integrating the knowledge of the frogs. And as he said, we need both. We need both of these for a healthy ecosystem. The problem, he said, is that we're telling everyone to become frogs. And when you do that in this rapidly changing world where you're not incentivizing or creating these sort of integrators, you really have a problem. It's bad for the individuals and it's bad for the ecosystem, by which he meant society, basically. And so I don't think that we need to like extinguish specialists or anything like that. I think we've tilted, you know, I think the research suggests that we have tilted too far in one direction with our cultural stories. Although the research is still showing that a lot of these people with breadth, despite that, are succeeding, and that's kind of actually the norm. But I think we shouldn't make, you know, people who are developing what I call range fight against the system. They shouldn't have to feel bad, right? So you mentioned that partly this book made you feel good, right? And there's some confirmation bias aspect of that, but that's true for anything that resonates with people. But you shouldn't have to feel bad about these things. We should be fostering these things. And I think for people who are feeling stuck, because that was your question, is people who are sort of feeling stuck and pushed towards specialization unnecessarily, you know, I think it's okay to go deep on something for a while. I think what's not okay is to keep doing it just for the sake of more specialization, or because in the short term, people view that as more sensible or more credible or whatever it is. Because there's also this wealth of research that I didn't write. I wrote a little bit about it in the book, but there's a lot more of it out there that shows that people do not quit stuff early enough when it comes to their careers. Like by the time they actually make a change, they should have. And one of these studies I do talk about in the book, done by the Freakonomics economist Steve Levitt, where by the time people are making a change, they should have made it quite a while ago. And so I think there are a number of things that people should do. I think they should approach their career development like those dark horses from Harvard, where they're constantly doing what's called self-regulatory learning, which is doing something, reflecting on how it fits you, how did it meet your expectations or not, how is it making you grow, what do you need to do next to grow more, who do you need to help, who do you need to, you know, enlist to help you do that. So I think taking this self-regulatory approach to learning, also expanding your networks. There's this very famous finding called the strength of weak ties, which shows that when people make career changes and moves, it's usually not the people in their inner network that help open a new door for them. It's the people, because those people kind of know the same stuff that they do already. It's these people sort of on the fringes of their network. So I think keep cultivating those fringes of your network. Use social media for that, right? Like don't let the algorithm just tell you who to follow. There's MIT study that showed that the people who are the best at this, they will prune off some of the people they follow, say on Twitter every week, and then add new people so that they don't just get focused into the same echo chamber by the algorithm. But I also think a really important thing to do for people who feel like they're getting pushed toward too much specialization is to find other people who will help them underwrite the risk for the kind of experimentation they need to do. Like when I was at Sports Illustrated, I even left for a while to do an internship at an investigative nonprofit startup just to try to learn skills that I knew I couldn't learn at Sports Illustrated, and then just hoped my job would be there when I went back. And it was because of a boss who I made my case to. He himself had been, you know, had gone to med school and then become a sports magazine writer, and then made my case. So then he realized that something that seemed insensible at first was totally sensible because it was going to add to my skill set that I was going to bring back. And so he, you know, he went to bat for me and allowed me to go do that and come back. And so I think telling your story to yourself repeatedly so that you can frame it to other people as a way to allow you to take some of these risks and allow you to broaden yourself is really important. And if I can give like a really, what to me has been an impactful example of that, where for the last about 5 years, I've been on a selection committee for something called the Pat Tillman Foundation, which is quite famous in the US, but I'm sure unknown elsewhere. It's Pat Tillman was an American football, professional American football player. And he left in the middle of his career, like, you know, was literally like playing in the NFL at the time, and to join the army because he didn't think that only, you know, lower income people should be serving in the army. And he was killed in Afghanistan. And the foundation is, it gives quite large money grants to veterans, soldiers, spouses of military members and things for career development. And so I've been on this admissions committee where it's like a 2% selection rate. You know, it's like very, very rare because it's very prestigious and it's, you know, a good chunk of money. And it's like, you know, I view myself as sort of like the joke, like the clown of the selection committee. It's like me and like three-star generals and all this stuff, but they want some outside eyes. And every year when we get these applications from people, and let's say a typical candidate, just hypothetically, is someone who, like, they go to high school or university and they graduate and they take some job and they find that it's like totally unfulfilling. And so they join the military and then they end up in some remote area of some other country, like administering medical aid or who knows what. And they realize that they're good at things that they didn't expect. And they are interested in things they didn't expect. They're bad at things that they didn't expect. And there are problems that they now are aware of that they weren't before. And so they come back and they want to change directions. This has given them these ideas of what they want to do and better idea of what they're good at and bad at. And the people every year, the people, if you think of like the distribution of scores for the applicants that we give as like an inverted U curve, you know, like a typical normal curve. So kind of, the lowest scored applications are these sort of zigzaggers who like look like they bounced around. Like I'll even get their resume, and even me knowing what I know, like I'm still human, you know, I'm not immune to cognitive biases that I write about, will say like, oh, this person really bounced around a lot. But then if these applications, you learn more about them, you learn about people they worked with, you know, and then you realize some of these people explain this as a series of pivots that they made based on their lived experience, saying, I thought this, then I did something and realized actually this other thing. And then I realized the problem I really wanted to tackle was this other thing. And those people get the highest scores, and they're like 90% of the people who win the scholarship. So the lowest scores are the people who zigzagged around and don't even attempt to explain it or even try to downplay it. The middle scores is a big mix of, you know, more narrow traditional path and some non-traditional path. But the large majority of the people who win are these ones who had this zigzagging journey. And instead of seeing it as a liability that they want to hide, they see it as an asset. The saying, here are the things I've been learning about myself. Wouldn't you want me to be pivoting in response to that, as opposed to just going forward no matter what I learn? And that's so convincing to us that we say, absolutely, here's a bunch of money and come join our, you know, the community. And so I think that's the same thing we all have to do at work, is we have to keep telling ourselves our narrative of why we made these moves, what we learned about ourselves, not only for ourselves, you know, and for keeping track of our own growth, but because when it's time to take sort of certain risks, that's the story that you need to tell to the people that you need to help you take those risks, basically.
When do we know that we sampled too much? When is it procrastination or being lazy or being afraid, you know, to risk something, putting down something on paper or whatever, and say, oh, let's sample a bit more? Yeah. Where is that line?
I think this is related to the previous answer. And I'm just, this is the point where I should apologize. Like my books are digressive in some ways, and that's me organizing myself. So like my brain just unfiltered is obviously very digressive. So when I was talking about sort of reflecting on what you've done, or what Herminia Ibarra, the London Business School professor who I interview and write about her work in the book, as she says, we learn who we are in practice, not in theory, which means that you have to act and then think. You know, there's all these like personality quizzes and stuff you can take that say like, oh, we'll tell you who you are and then you'll know what to go do. Or you can just introspect and look inside yourself. Really, the psychology literature shows that you have to do something and then reflect on it to figure out who you are. And that's how we learn about our interests and abilities in these things. And the way you do that is through this self-regulatory learning, which largely comes down to reflection, to systematic reflective practices. So for me, I have something I call, this is my book of small experiments. It's Alice in Wonderland, doing Curiouser and Curiouser. And I think that what you want to do is have explicit questions. You want to become like a scientist of yourself. And one of the most important things that scientists do is lay out a question before they do the experiment. It doesn't matter if their intuition about what the answer will be is right or wrong, because as long as they lay out the question before, there's something called pre-registration that scientists are increasingly made to do. As long as they lay out the question before, no matter what happens, they will learn something important from their experiments. And I think that's pretty similar. You know, I'm drawing an analogy from that to the self-regulatory learning literature, where you should have a question about, am I going to be interested in this aspect of it? Will I be good at this aspect of it? Do I need this to succeed at X thing? Lay that question out, then do the thing, systematically be reflecting back on how did this fit me? What met my expectations and what didn't? What surprised me that I need to be good at this? What did I see about other people that are doing this? You know, who would I like to be and who do I need to help me? And so once I learned about that literature, I started keeping this, what I say, this book of small experiments, where I, at least every other month, force myself to have a question to investigate, whether that's just talking to someone in a job field I don't know about to see if it's something I'm interested in, or taking an online class or getting involved in something. And through that keeping track of the reflections, because it turns out that you will basically not remember them sort of accurately unless you're writing them down. So I think that's important to actually journal about this stuff, that you will increasingly come to understand your own interests and abilities and the things that you need to learn. And so I think when you're going through a sampling period, if you're just bouncing around aimlessly and like hoping for lightning to strike and like, you know, maybe you'll get lucky, but probably not. And so I think what people who are going through this period need to do, because you know, the job world is changing so fast. So I don't think people can't really expect to have like the same, be doing the same thing for a career, for their whole career anymore, for the most part, with some exceptions. And so I think now this is becoming like a process that you go through your entire career, because not only are you changing, but the work world is changing underneath you. And so I think this process of increasingly working toward better and better match quality, again, that degree of fit between your interests and abilities in the work that you do, that's very important for performance, very important for sense of fulfillment, very important for preventing burnout. It turns out people very rarely get burned out when they have very high match quality work. It doesn't exhaust them the same way. It energizes them more. And so I think you have to keep tabs on that. Like, what am I learning from this, instead of just bouncing around randomly?
Can I ask you a personal question now?
Yeah, because, of course.
You have this career, you have this successful book, you travel the United States, and you are a father now.
Yeah.
Your way of life, your way of approaching things is, you know, you waste time to learn, to have range. How do you do it with a child? I mean, when you become a parent, my experience at least is suddenly time disappeared.
Yeah.
And I must become more specialized, more conscious, more, you know, oh, I have to say no to that. And being, you know, a generalist and sampling sounds such a luxury right now.
Yeah.
How can you balance that?
It's interesting you say that, because that's an especially poignant question for me, I think, because what I view as a lot of my competitive advantage in writing both of my books was the fact that I was willing to, or had the luxury to, or whatever you want to call it, to kind of spread my brain so far that I was inevitably would go down reading some scientific literature that would lead me down some rabbit hole that at first I thought was interesting, and then it would turn out, and I would, you know, 2 weeks later or something, I'd say, how did I ever think I was going to write about this? This was not what I expected. And at first I used to chastise myself for that, because I'd say, like, I have to get more efficient at this. This is ridiculous. But then I realized that it's like, you know, there's these similar findings in, like, whether it's how you invest in the stock market or like how scientific innovation happens, which is you actually have to accept a lot of this, like, meandering and things not going well if you want to also capture the good stuff. And so I realized, like, one of my best competitive advantages is that this willingness to have some inefficiency meant that I would find things that other researchers and writers didn't, basically, and that I can't actually eliminate that. So not only do I, like, want to have that because I like being curious about a lot of different things, but I also feel that I have to have it for the work that I do, or else there's no longer anything, like, special about the work that I do. So it's essential for me. I think as a parent, I have had to be a little more kind of directed about it. And so I've, again, instead of just, like, totally random, because I really would, like, randomly bounce around scientific papers and things like that, I am more likely to go in with a certain question now. And this sort of happened because I read this scientific paper. I think the title was Curiosity Made the Cat More Creative. And basically it was about how people use the internet. That might've been the subtitle, but it was part of the title. About how people use the internet. And it showed that, like, a lot of people, the majority of people use the internet, like, a little bit for information, but mostly for, like, memes and entertainment and humor and following people like themselves and playing games and stuff. And not that there's anything wrong with that at all, but a smaller portion of people, much smaller portion, you know, could do some of that stuff, but primarily use the internet for information seeking. And what it found was that the best thing people could do, like, that like just random brainstorming is, like, not that effective. It turns out there's a whole literature on this. If you're just like, okay, I'm going to sit here and just, like, come up with a lot of ideas, that it sounds good, but it doesn't really work very well. And what this paper showed was that what the best thing is to go into your internet searching with a question, like, have some specific question. You know, you saw some magic trick on YouTube. How does that work? And that these lead to these, like, series of connections that people don't foresee. And they end up with this incredible ability to generate ideas. So for me, like, something I want to write about, it's not developed enough yet, but started with, I was wondering, why is the chemical symbol for tungsten on the periodic table a W, where all the other ones start with the letter they start with? So that's silly, right? But I'm like, why did I think that? And so I start going down this rabbit hole. It's simple. It just came from a German word. But in going down that rabbit hole, it turned into something that, like, is going to be, like, a really important writing project for me. So I think now I'm much more liable to start with a specific question, whereas before I would just, like, go, like, splash all over the place, and maybe I would come up with a question eventually. And so I think I have to be a little more directed about it. I think I now have to turn off my phone when I'm doing my work and research, whereas before I could kind of have it by me and check it here and there because I didn't have to be as efficient with my time. But that's been a huge, I did, you know, one of my writer friends here wrote in a book that about taking all of the discretionary apps off his phone for a month and then only adding back the ones that he really thought would add value to his life. So I did that and ended up spending a lot less time on my phone. So I think that's some of it. I think the difficulty is that this experimentation really pays off in the long term. It's that in the short term, but I think this is a lifelong process too, because of this finding I write about in the book called The End of History Illusion, which is this finding that if you ask people, they will always say, you know, did you learn a lot about yourself? Have you changed a lot from your experiences in life? And they'll always say, oh yeah, of course. And you say, well, do you think you're going to change more? And people say, like, no, not really. Now I kind of know who I am. And they say that at every time point in life, and every time point underestimate future change of their values, how they want to spend their time, what they want in friends, all what they think they're good at, all these things, and just keeps changing. The fastest period of change is about age 18 to about 28, but it never stops. It never stops. It slows down, but never stops. And so I think we have to be conscious of the fact that we are also changing. And so it's probably not helpful for most people to have this idea that, like, I'll try a few things and then I will have this perfect spot for the rest of my life. Because not only does the work world change, but you also change.
In the previous interview, we talked about the expression jack of all trades, and it was a revelation for me because I didn't know the whole expression. Can you say the story again?
Yeah, so I think it's very culturally telling that the full quote is, jack of all trades, master of none, oftentimes better than master of one. But we have lopped off the end. So turning it from praise for people with range to denigration. And when I was sort of looking into the origin of that phrase, one of the things that struck me was that the first written account of jack of all trades was actually in New Latin, Johannes Factotum. And it was an insult leveled at a young poet who didn't have higher education. He was trying to write plays, he was trying to act, he was trying to run a theater company, et cetera. He was being like a copyist for scripts and all these things. And the man being insulted was William Shakespeare, a young William Shakespeare. And so I thought it was so interesting that one of his colleagues looked at him and said, like, this guy's trying to do like way too much. He's just going to be a failure. And obviously he turned out okay.
Actually, when I was studying theater in London, our teacher used to have a picture of Shakespeare with a clown nose because I studied physical theater and had a lot of circus stuff. And he told us that actually Shakespeare was not a playwright. He was an artistic director of some sort. His actors were not just actors who said, "Give me my lines and I will tell them." They were moving libraries of texts, of tragic texts. So they also had their own character on stage. So he knew how to set them, how to combine it. It's like writing a song with loops,
Interesting.
but living loops. So he knew how to place them. He would let them work, kind of an improvisation technique, and he will get what he needed and then write the final
Interesting.
dialogue on that.
That's amazing. And that's really interesting. I didn't know that. And it makes me wonder again, you know, there's some obvious links from his diver like he was a poet and he writes an iambic pentameter, you know, in his plays and things like that. But that's so interesting and makes me wonder even more how his sort of involvement in the totality of the theater,
Yes.
you know, gave him this ability to think in different ways and you know, see what he was creating from sort of a different stance of the people around him. It reminded me of one of my favorite novelists, Haruki Murakami, has this quote, something like, if you only read the same things that everyone else is reading, you can only think the same thoughts that everyone else is thinking. And so I wonder if by, you know, having a sort of different background and taking that different approach helped him be such a phenomenally unique thinker for such a for over so many productions too.
Yes. I was thinking that after you wrote the book, the pandemic happened. And one of the things that happened to us is that we were locked down in our houses. We lost maybe a lot of these chance contacts, these accidents that can help us with meeting people, I mean. And our life became more online. Do you see a bad outcome from that? Do you see the world a bit worse after that?
I think there's a challenge for sure. Here, let me see if I can bring up one more little visualization, if you bear with me for a sec, that I think
Of
might be
course.
helpful. This is a network map from researchers who study groups of teams, basically, that give rise to like creative performance. And what you can see here, each one of these, where you see the like colors next to one another, those are repeat collaborations of people on the same team. And there's plenty of that. But there's also this crossing over. And what that is showing is that these are there are people going from one team to another. And the researchers call this, you know, they're taking knowledge that's known on one team and bringing it somewhere else, where it's suddenly seen as something that's invention. And the researchers call this an import-export business of ideas. And it is like the hallmark of groups of teams that give creative that have creative outputs. Like they looked at, you know, creators of Broadway plays and, you know, all the way to like physicists. And if you don't have that import-export business of ideas, if you just see mostly or only repeat collaborations, you know, nobody coming in and out, then you better hope that's a kind learning environment, that they're facing the same kind of challenges over and over and over and over again. It really reminds me of an engineer named Bill Gore, who's famous here because he founded the company that created the material Gore-Tex. And he fashioned the company after his observation that organizations do their most impactful work in times of crisis because the disciplinary boundaries fly out the window and people start learning from their colleagues and how they can help one another. Or as he liked to say, real communication happens in the carpool, right? Through this serendipity. And I think that's great, but I do worry in this increasingly remote world, like, where's the carpool? There's already some evidence that group Zoom discussions, that interruptions are actually sort of good for idea creation, and that in Zoom people like don't interrupt each other because it's you know sort of more formal. So I do worry about that. I think we have these tools where we can expose ourselves to more people. And I got to see like a bunch of speakers that I never would have been able to see from all over the world during the pandemic because they were giving virtual talks. But I think we're going to have to be a lot more thoughtful about engineering our own import-export business of ideas when it comes to our networks, when it comes to the flow of information into our brains. Because if we're not more thoughtful about it, I don't think we can leave it up to serendipity the same way if we're not in areas that are ripe for serendipity. And I think for a lot of the ways we spend our time online, you know, there are algorithms invisibly channeling us to seeing the same things over and over again. And you sort of have to push against that. So I am concerned about this. And I think it means we're going to have to be a lot more thoughtful about, you know, because people don't like go on Zoom with random people like they would at a conference and say like, oh, let's just like toss around ideas. Whereas that happens like, that's like the main thing that happens at conferences. So I think we have a capacity to take in more information, which is great. Connect with people that are farther away, which is great. But I think we're going to have to be a lot more thoughtful about creating our own personal import-export business of ideas, or else we're going to lose out on what serendipity, you know, gave us before.
We would expect the top companies, the companies that have the money and the people, like Facebook and Alphabet and Amazon, to know this stuff already. They would be looking for this book and they read it the first day and said, this is what we should do in our company. Have you seen a good implementation, maybe not of your book, you know, with your name on it, but an implementation of this knowledge now that you have written the book, that you have talked about? Have you seen like a place, a company or an organization that uses that?
Oh, yeah. I'd say a number of them, you know, and obviously we're doing this like go before me, they were doing it on, you mentioned Alphabet, for example, like they brought me in to talk to this, their arm they call X, which is that like sort of their like moonshot projects. And they established it because they realized that once you become sort of larger and have more momentum as a company, you stop doing that kind of wide. This is in the research literature, this is called the explore-exploit trade-off. Where there was just some seminal research showing that when people have a hot streak at work, it's always preceded by this period of more exploration where they're kind of trying different things and then they find something that hits and they exploit, which means not the bad use of exploit, it means that you just you use this thing that you found and to be productive. And when companies find something that works, they go from explore mode to exploit mode, the better they do, the more they stick with the thing they are exploiting. This is, you know, one of the famous examples is like Kodak, which discovered digital photography and then like pushed it away because they said like, well, why would we get away from undermine the things that are already working for us? And so they just scuttled it. So Alphabet has X where they say, we want this to be explore mode. And they bring in people, they have teams. It's like an engineer and a computer scientist and a puppeteer. And they're just like, try to take on these huge projects. And that's what gave rise to Waymo, their autonomous driving. And so it's doing this incredible work. And they put people in these crazy teams. So I think they're doing what they're doing. I was also just with a super successful investment company in Scotland called Baillie Gifford. And they both I think what they and X do at Alphabet is they say, okay, instead of hiring people that do what we already do really well, so we can just slot them in on day one and they'll hit the ground running, we're going to hire people with stuff, skills, experiences, whatever, that we could never give them, that we can't get in any other way, that we can't cultivate internally. And then we can give them the stuff. We can coach them up on the stuff that we're good at. So Baillie Gifford, like they literally won't hire anyone with an MBA. So it was super interesting to be around them because everyone you talk to, PhD in, you know, Spanish literature or whatever it is, theology. And then they say, we can teach you the finance stuff, but we can't teach you these other ways of thinking that you've learned and these other social networks that you have that wouldn't be connected to otherwise. And I think that's something that I've seen a number of organizations where they say, we're going to hire for stuff that we can't create and then give them the stuff we know well. You know, another example of once people are already in, I think, is 3M, where I write about some in the book, which is 3M I wasn't used to thinking of 3M as like an innovative company. I just knew it for like post-its and like this and like these sticky tabs that I put like on books when I'm doing research. And so when I was looking at these innovation rankings of companies around the world, it's like how peer companies rate each other. And the first ones were totally intuitive. It's like Alphabet, you know, Apple, et cetera. And then 3M is usually like in the top five. And I'm like, what? And so I started learning about them and realizing they have this thing they call an innovation index, where they have to make a quarter of their profit every year from products that didn't even exist 5 years ago. Didn't even exist. They're in like every sector, aeronautics, you know, surgical tools, all this stuff. And they have 7,000 inventors. And so they realize they need to be constantly kind of disrupting themselves. And so they take these inventors and they have something called like they encourage them. They like set up fairs where they can go and just like learn about one another's work, like a high school science fair, you know? And they have these visualizations, like one they call the periodic table of technologies, that is shaped like the periodic table, but it shows all of the different things that are done in the company. And it's basically encouraging people to say, like, get outside your lane and go connect to someone in a different area. And so one of the women I wrote about in the book from 3M, a woman named Jayshree Seth, who was one of their top scientists, she just actually won after the book. So I didn't have, you know, it was too late for me to put it in. She just won the highest award from the Society of Women Engineers that you can win in the world, Lifetime Achievement Award. And as she told me, she kept like moving away from things she had studied for her master's degree, for her PhD, because she frankly found them boring. And people told her like, well, you can't shift now, you'll get behind. And she said, like, what's getting behind for a year or two of study compared to like the 50 years I'm going to be working, you know? And so at 3M, she'll say, like, I'm not an expert in anything. What I do, she calls it her mosaic building process, where she's almost like a journalist. She goes around her own colleagues, says, you know, what are you working on? What are your challenges? All these things. And then she'll do that until she's gotten a certain question that she thinks applies to people in a number enough different areas that she'll then bring them together and pitch them on saying, here's why you should all work together, because you're revolving around the same thing. You're just not seeing what these other people are doing. You know, you're all in your own trench and not standing up to look over and see that the solution is in the trench next to you. And so she combines them. And by doing that, you know, she's become like one of the most impactful innovators in the country.
You talk about range as a beneficial way to, for work, for sports, for science, for art. How about in our lives? Can it help us become better spouses, better parents, which is what I really want to know?
Yeah, that's a great question. I mean, when I turned in the first manuscript of the book was like literally the day my wife went into labor. Wow. So I've been thinking about it as a parent, you know, much more since then. And one of the things I sort of learned about during the reporting and then even more after gave me kind of an analogy that I think of for parenting. And this is going to sound bad because the analogy comes from the military, you know, like liking your parenting to the military. But I write in Range about how the U.S. Army had this problem starting in the mid-90s, where basically the people they identified as the most talented were just leaving like crazy. And they, even after they had been funded and all this stuff. And at first they thought, you know, it was just like millennials, like weren't tough or whatever. And then a group of officers and scientists decided to study the problem and found, no, we haven't developed this like toughness problem overnight. Surprise, surprise. We developed a match quality problem, where when most of the economy was industrial and so people could face similar problems from one year to the next, lateral mobility was very limited. That worked. The Army was like that, and it was like the rest of the economy. But then you fast forward to this information age or knowledge age or creativity age, whatever you want to call it. And now we prize people who can engage in knowledge creation and creative problem solving. And those people have tons of lateral mobility. And so these young people who were learning things about themselves in their late teens and early 20s but having no agency over career changing to match that, would just leave. At first, the Army threw money at them to stay. And the people who are going to stay anyway took it. The ones who are going to leave left anyway. $500 million of taxpayer money didn't change retention 0.1%. But it's only taxpayer money, so who cares? And then they started these programs, like one called talent-based branching, for example, where they take a cadet and they pair them with sort of like a coach, like mentor figure, that the cadet can pick that person, just someone in their, you know, in their life or work. And they have them try a career path. They dip into a career path they reflect on how it fits them. They have to keep track of their reflections in an online portal, and they have to dip into at least 5 different career paths. And one of the interesting things that came out of this, one, if you look at the research, is actually some of them found out that they were bad at things they expected to be good at, which was not a pleasant surprise. But others found out that they were interested in things they thought would be boring, which was a much more pleasant surprise. But importantly, 90% of the cadets who went through talent-based branching changed their career choice, 90%. And that improved retention where money bonuses had not. And as one of the researchers doing this work described to me, he said, when you get fit, it looks like grit. Meaning that if you get people in work that fits them well, high match quality, they will display the characteristics of grit, like perseverance, you know, like staying with it, even if they didn't before. Grit is what psychologists call a state, not a trait. A trait is something inherent to you no matter what you're doing. A state might be a stable function of you, but in a given context. And so finding that context where people display these qualities you want, I think is the trick. And that's an analogy to parenting for me, where I view myself as like that coach-like mentor figure in the talent-based branching process, my son obviously being the cadet, where I arranged some experiences for him. You know, that's always going to be limited based on like what's available wherever you are. And really, you know, I've read enough for my first book, which was about genetics. I've read enough behavioral genetics to know that parents don't create kids to the degree that they think they do. You know, you can ruin a kid with deprivation. But above a certain level of enrichment, they're going to kind of become who they're going to become. And I think the best thing you can do is help them express that fully and figure out their interests and talents. And so I think what my role is to make sure that my son gets the maximum amount of signal about who he is, what he wants to do, what options are available from every one of these experiences. So there's an OECD report out maybe like 2 years ago that showed that kids now start limiting what they think their potential future job options look like from age 7. And so I think we have to work against that by providing some of these opportunities. But I think the best thing you can do is help them get the most learning they can out of each experience. You know, asking them what worked and what didn't, trying to help them figure out the difference between just having a bad day and something that really isn't a fit. And so that's what I'm doing right now. I mean, my son is 3, so there's only so much of this to do, right? He can't be too reflective. But I try, even if he's doing something like drawing. You know, I read this book by this great comic artist named Linda Berry, where she says one of the things that holds adults back from drawing is we're like self-conscious about it, basically. And you just like, so you won't sort of try and experiment anymore. And so she recommends all these exercises like drawing with 2 hands at the same time. It turns out to actually be surprisingly easier than I expected. And so when my son is drawing or something, I'll just like suggest, like, here's another one. Want to see if you can do 2 hands at the same time? And sometimes he'll ignore me and sometimes he'll give it a try. And if it's something that he likes, then he'll keep doing it. And so at this age, I think it's just to make suggestions for things that he might like or be interested in. And as he gets a little older, for him to become self-reflective in this way, where he's getting the maximum amount of learning from each of his experiences.
I think it's very clear the way you present it. I really love the word signal, because it's not failure, it's not success, it's signal. It's ones and zeros, and the more ones and zeros you get, the better informed you are about what you like, what you can do. And I remember when I was young, my father really wanted me to do sports, and he took me to swimming and to gymnastics and, you know, this singular atomic sports that I didn't like. There was no game in that. So the conclusion was that I don't like sports. I'm not good at sports, that I don't like sports. But I love tennis. I love football. I love playing with other people. But I hated being alone. I once tried archery because I like bows and arrows. But it's the most boring sport in the world. You are completely alone. You just shoot 3 arrows. We wait the others to finish and go. You pick up your arrows and that's it. Because you told me the other day about drawing with 2 hands, and I said I will try it with my son. I want to show you.
Oh, nice! He's drawing. I love it.
He really liked it.
Oh, good. That's great. I'm glad to hear it. You can give him. How old is your son? He looks like probably pretty similar age to mine.
He's 2 years and 3 months tomorrow.
Okay, great. That's really cool. And that's a great story about you as a kid too, right? Like what you learned is there's a social aspect to some sports that is
exactly,
really important to you. Whereas, you know, I was a distance runner, and for a lot of like the really long distance runners, it's actually the solitude is what they like about some of what they're doing. And so I think learning those lessons instead of saying, oh, I don't like sports, is really, really important. Figuring out what aspect of it makes it something worthwhile for you.
So my final question is, do people who are generalists, who have range in their life, do they have something in common? Do they have common characteristics, like the way they live, in their face, in their attitude? Are they similar in some way?
I think, and this is actually me just speculating a little, but I think curiosity for sure. Like, I think, you know, it's funny because I interviewed a huge number of academics and scientists for this book, and a lot of them are like, in many ways, the epitome of specialists. And as important, you know, they had knowledge that I wanted to learn about, but it was also interesting how often, you know, once the formal part of the interview was sort of done and we're just like chit-chatting, how often they would say, like, you know, when I got into this intellectual, like, life of the mind in academia, I really thought I was going to be able to like spread my wings more and have, you know, engage more diverse interests. And I remember this conversation with someone I interviewed, with a woman who was saying, like, I feel this like pressure to be specialized so that I can like just publish, you know, an enormous number of papers like quickly. But this isn't like what I got into this for, you know, that it was because I was curious. And I looked at her research page, and every single one of her published papers that she had listed had like Aristotle in the title, every single one. And she still felt that she was not like specialized, you know? And so I think curiosity, you know, unfortunately sometimes in this debate, curiosity can be seen as a liability instead of an asset. I think that's a problem. But also I really think that approach that I mentioned about the Dark Horse Project, and by the way, it's called the Dark Horse Project because it was sort of renamed in the middle because it was studying again how people find fulfilling work. Some of those people were very materially successful, but the dependent variable was fulfillment, not income or anything. And there were some people who followed a linear path. It was just a small minority. And the typical, again, is this sort of bouncing around path where people say, here's who I am, you know, here are my skills and interests now, here are the opportunities. Maybe I'll change a year from now because I will have learned something about myself or my opportunities will have changed. And those people would come into their interviews in this study and say, like, well, don't tell people to do what I did because, you know, I did this weird path and then kind of came out of nowhere. A dark horse is an expression. I don't know if it translates, but it's an expression for someone who comes out of nowhere. And that turned out to be the norm. And so I think that approach of like constant reevaluation is something that these people didn't set out to say, like, well, I'm going to be a generalist. It was, they were very focused on finding things that fit them well. And because that caused them to go like this, they end up with this breadth. I mean, in many ways that was similar for me. It was one, I wanted to engage my curiosity and finding things that fit for me required that. And so I think it's kind of a wide range of curiosity for sure. People are curious. And also, you know, some agitation almost about finding the right fit and not settling until you've done that. And that requires like looking at a lot of different things. And so I think those are some of the commonalities, but there were also sort of more specific things. Like when I was talking to, again, with like 3M, when I was talking to inventors, or when I was looking at the work of a professor named Abby Griffin, who studies serial innovators. And when she describes who they are, you know, they have a need to learn across multiple domains. They really want people in their network who study different domains. They read more and more widely than their peers. She said they appear to flit among ideas, which doesn't normally sound like a compliment. They connect information from disparate sources. They repurpose old things in new ways, so-called lateral thinking. And these are all just like quotes that came out of her work of who these people are. And she would also note things like, oh, even if they were, let's say they were an engineer or whatever, or the woodworker, whatever they were, even if they had like a great lab or studio or whatever at the office, they would have like a little one at home too, because they just wanted to like, they needed tinkering space, right? And sometimes the lab or the shop or the studio could be sort of too official. So they still wanted their own kind of tinkering space. So that seemed to be something that showed up along with hobbies unrelated to work.
Actually, I have something in mind, so I'll make my more honest question. I get this idea that all this attitude that those people have sounds like a more childish, a more playful attitude towards life. So I was wondering, maybe hoping, I don't know, that these people, do they look younger than their age?
Oh, that's a good question. You know, a lot of these, sometimes these people I was like talking to on the phone and things like that. So I don't know how a lot of them look, to be honest.
Okay.
But I think there is something to that. I got invited to this class, a Yale music professor who had Craig Wright. Okay, I'm looking at it right now. He wrote a book called The Hidden Habits of Genius. And he invited me to his, you know, he was a music professor, but he sort of taught this class just more broadly on creativity. And one of the things he told me was that he felt like a childish streak was common to like all these geniuses that he studied. And he would cite things like that I didn't know about. They say, you know, Mozart sometimes at a party would like get down all fours and bark like a dog, just like out of fun. And so that was interesting to me because I've sort of thought of myself as, I don't mean to like be, I'm not equating myself like a genius or anything like that, but I have thought of myself as childish sometimes, like enjoying playful things, you know, wanting some room to be silly, to try things I'm a beginner at. And so that sort of struck a chord with me. And I do think there is a childishness to, like when I was talking about these, you know, an inventor who has like a great lab at work, but then they just want to play with stuff at home or paint stuff or solder stuff or whatever. And so I do think there's that sort of childish beginner's mind aspect to it of never feeling like you've arrived and sort of like being hungry to learn
yes.
more. So, so I think there is something to that.
Because I look at you and you look younger than your age.
Yeah.
And I don't know, maybe I don't know if there is a research about that. I don't know how you can measure such a thing.
That would be cool. That's an interesting question. I my guess is that there nobody has studied that, but I don't know. There's another question for me to go on the internet because there is certainly a word in research for sort of people who are more baby faced called neotenous. And so I'm gonna definitely gonna look if there's like something about like personality and neotenous facial features or something like that. I haven't come across it.
Okay.
Skeptical's there, but I'm going to look and let you know.
Okay, David, thank you very much for your time. I really appreciate it. I'm, again, deeply honored for coming to this interview twice. I have to say that this book is, because it is difficult to be a generalist in a specialized world, but this book gives you confidence. This book makes you feel better and more sure about yourself, so you can actually work better to sell your idea and to persuade people that this actually works. Trust me, we'll do it. We don't know what it is yet, but it will happen.
Well, it's very gratifying to hear, and it's been a pleasure. You know, one of the perks for me is to get to talk about my interests and hear how they do or don't resonate with people who've read deeply. So I really appreciate this conversation.